So, heading towards our first technical presentation, I would like to invite Dr. Akbar Hussain, who is trained as an architect at the University of Minnesota, USA. He developed an interest in architectural, urban, and landscape history while teaching at Lahore's National College of Arts. This interest matured during a period of doctoral investigation in the landscape studies at the University of Edinburgh, UK, during 1990 and 94. He has been teaching at various architectural schools around the globe, and currently Dr. Sen is associated with the Imperial College of Business Studies, Lahore, at departmental head. So I would like to invite Dr. Saab to present his presentation. The title for his presentation is Promoting Communal Use of Vegetable Historic Food.
After that high tech dose from Dr. Atawar Rahman, I'm going to take you back several centuries. So you'll have to tune in to another wavelength, I'm afraid. I'm going to talk about Bijapur, which was a Muslim capital in the 17th century in southern India. In 2012, I was invited by trust that is responsible for the conservation and development of Bijapur. And the reason why I was asked was because I had done some work on gardens for my doctoral study, gardens in the Indian subcontinent. And I had worked especially on Bijapur and Golconda, the two Sultanate kingdoms of the 17th century. So that was an opportunity for me to look at Bijapur, and although I'm not going to be talking about the gardens, I just thought that I would use my experience of having visited Bijapur and center my talk about on the city itself. So I have prepared a paper, and it has sections in it, and I thought that perhaps I would just read the paper and then talk about the various slides as they come along. They are synchronized with the paper, so there shouldn't be any problem, and I think it will speed up the process considerably. So, a 17th century painting at the Metropolitan Museum of Art called the House of, how does it work? Called the House of Bijapur, depicts the eight rulers of the Adil Shahi dynasty seated on a carpet from the dynasty's founder, Yusuf Adil Khan, to the last Sultan, Sikandar. It is an imaginary, multi-generational, courtly painting of a type that was produced at the Mughal court and serves well as an introduction to the concern of this paper with Bijapur, the legacy of the Adil Shahi Sultans of Peninsular India. The city of Bijapur, now known as Vijayapura, was the capital of the Adil Shahi Sultanate until it was conquered by the Mughals in 1686, after flourishing for almost two centuries. Together with Golconda, the other Sultanate of the 16th and 17th centuries in southern India, Bijapur contributed to making the Deccan one of the most dynamic, diverse, and cosmopolitan societies in the early modern world, as observed by cultural historian Richard Eaton in 2008. At its peak, the boundaries of the Bijapur Sultanate stretched from the Arabian Sea to the Bay of Bengal, making it the second largest political entity in the subcontinent after the Mughal Empire. And with a population of over a million, it rivaled the main administrative and cultural centers of Mughal India. After its Mughal takeover, Bijapur's political circumstances changed rapidly. Although it enjoyed prosperity initially as part of the Nizam of Hyderabad's Deccan dominions, it was ceded to the Maratha Peshwa in 1760 following which it passed on to the British India East India Company. After the Indian independence, it was absorbed first in Bombay State and later in Mysore State. With a present population of 300,000, for 50% Muslims and 50% Hindus, Jains, Christians and Buddhists, Bijapur is a small, dusty, neglected town of Karnataka state whose built legacy may be at the risk of oblivion, although it has received some attention lately from the Archaeological Survey of India for its architectural and garden remains. Located on the leeward side of the Western Ghats in the rain shadow cast by the mountain range, the Bijapur district remains relatively dry with arid to semi-arid conditions. Consequently, water storage and supply played an important role historically in the establishment and sustenance of Bijapur's population. The water management system of the Adil Shahis is well known. Henry Cousins, who wrote an account of Bijapur in 1889, noted that the waterworks of Bijapur, like those of all Muhammadan towns, were in their day perfect. Abundance of pure wholesome water was brought into the city from two tanks without the city. These sources, being without the walls, could easily be cut off by an army invading the city, but this contingency was evidently foreseen and met by the plentiful distribution of tanks and wells within the walls supplied from these sources, and which when once filled would render the besieged city independent of the source for several months. These tanks and wells within the city walls were once supplied with water via tunnels from the tanks outside the city. The tunnels had earth pipes and water towers were located at intervals. Water towers or ganges as they are called were located at intervals along their course. You can see the ganges here and the water, the tunnels from the tank all the way into the citadel. The tunnels and earth pipes and water towers were located at intervals along the courses. Each tower or ganj, 25 to 40 feet high, served to release pressure that was built up in the pipes and maintained water in a clean condition by trapping slush and silt at the bottom. Okay, my next heading is heritage sites. Bijapur's Islamic heritage sites are made up of both secular and religious buildings. These may be grouped into four categories: forts, bastions, and watchtowers. The citadel and the surrounding city, each with its surrounding moat, bastions, gates, and walls, with an outer circuit of over 6 miles, enclosing 1,300 acres, are attractions for local and international tourists. The second heritage sites are water reservoirs and conduits, including tanks, stepped wells, or bodies as they are called in India, water towers or ganges, and karais systems. The Bijapur karais was one of the most extensive systems of urban water supply constructed in southern India in the latter half of the 16th century. Among the various secular amenities that the Adil Shahi Sultans provided their capital city were the public step wells or bodies. As noted earlier, these were the main sources of water supply for this fortified city of the Deccan. Taj Body, Bijapur's pride in the 17th century, is now located within a crowded area of the city and its walls are encroached upon by houses of local residents. It is the largest stepped well of Bijapur and is named after Taj Sultana, the favorite queen of Ali of Adil Shah II. Both are built square in shape with each side measuring 225 feet. The body is entered through a wide arch flanked by two majestic minarets in signature Adil Shahi style. According to an inscription engraved on a plaque against a wall near the entrance gate, It was built by Malik Sandal, a Sindhi official in the service of the Adil Shahi court. The inscription translates as, "The humble slave Malik Sandal constructed at his own expense the building of Taj Bori for the service of religious mendicants, as a hammam for bathing, and as a resting place for the people of Allah. Whoever seeks possession of it or damages it, may his wife and mother ride a donkey and be overtaken by an eternal curse." So the third set of heritage sites, mosques, mausolea, and associated gardens, of which the better known are the Jami Masjid, the Ibrahim Roza, and the Gol Gumbaz. The latter two combine mausoleums and mosques, each with a set of mausoleum and mosque on a large square platform facing each other across a reservoir and fountain. Both the Ibrahim Roza and the Gol Gumbaz have surrounding gardens. With elaborate arrangements for water storage and supply. The water arrangements and the surrounding gardens are the focus of considerable exploratory work that has been carried out by the Archaeological Survey of India, but with which remains unpublished to date. The Gol Gumbaz is well known locally for its whispering gallery located at the springing of the dome and the size of its dome, which in terms of its internal diameter, 125 feet, and covered area of 18,000 square feet, is exceeded only by that of St. Peter's in Rome, as most tourist guides invariably inform you. The last set of heritage buildings, heritage sites, palaces, judicial courts, and office buildings, including palaces such as the Gagan Mahal and Asar Mahal within the citadel. Which have tanks and gardens, making them popular destinations for local and international tourists. Henry Cousins, to whom reference was made earlier, observed that every building of significance in Bijapur has some remarkable features peculiar to itself in terms of construction or decoration. The Gol Gumbaz with its enormous dome and gigantic deep dans for minarets, the Jamia Masjid with its glittering mihrab, the Asar Mahal with exquisite wall paintings, the Gagan Mahal with its great arch, and the Ibrahim Roza for its hanging ceiling, grouping of miniature minarets, and perforated lace-like parapets. Problems and issues. As noted by Anwar Punekar in his paper of 2006 on Bijapur's conservation, which is published in a book called Designing Sustainable Cities in the Developing World, the current picture of Bijapur's deteriorating historic core is symptomatic of the cultural alienation of the local population with its built heritage. This is inevitable, perhaps, in the approach to conservation embodied in national level heritage protection, that is, the Archaeological Survey of India, which we know has been largely concerned with the conservation of individual heritage sites devoid of their social and physical context. The conservation apparatus thus is designed to institute alienation. But if the ASI has failed to provide area conservation strategies in Bijapur, local authorities too, burdened with providing basic services and overrun by financial deficit, to quote Punekar, have also failed to protect heritage and to assess what values are assessed to this heritage, are attached to this heritage by local communities. Punekar observes that in Bijapur, some monuments and monument precincts are in good repair with well-maintained landscaped areas, but the historic core as a whole is in rundown condition. The historic core has significant historic monuments, he says, but as is true of many historic Islamic cities, these monuments were built as symbols of political power, and the urban fabric attached to these monuments was made up of non-monumental building stock, which was destined to disappear after it had served its contemporary users. Among other issues to which Pune Car draws the reader's attention is that of the non-implementation of building control regulations. We are all familiar with this. In the protected and regulated area near or adjoining protected monuments, and the fact that local communities, developers and entrepreneurs have a relatively free hand in ordering building works. This situation, notes Pune Car, has led to development which is unsympathetic with the historic core, as well as to problems of encroachment, dilapidation and polarization of communities. Next, please. And the next one. As you can see, development is very close to the enclosing wall of the monuments. Next. And the next one. Open areas surrounding monumental precincts and city walls are owned by government municipal authorities or absentee landlords and are frequently encroached upon by squatters. Next, please. Such is the case with the stepped wells or bodies, as stated earlier. Finally, as in all top-down legislation, the ASI does not maintain close links with local town planning and city management authorities. The ASI, Pune Car points out, is a central government department, while all other departments active in Bijapur, including tourism development, are state government departments. There is no collaboration between the state and central government departments, and anyway, any kind of collaboration would raise questions as to who is in charge and of which part of the process. Okay, the next heading is potential. Bijapur's historic core has the potential to be a coherent center and a binder of the town's urban fabric. It comprises potential foci which can be appropriated by local communities to construct new identities and meanings that have relevance in the contemporary context of the town. Among these foci are the two mausoleums that describe the eastern and western limits of the walled city, namely the Gol Gumbaz and the Ibrahim Roza, as well as the unfinished mausoleum of Ali Adil Shah II. These mausoleums with extensive open spaces and gardens are popular destinations for the local communities for whom they serve as a sanctuary in the hot and dry conditions that prevail in Bijapur for much of the year. Bijapur's stepped wells or bodies were of considerable social importance. These bodies continued to meet the water needs. I know the word here is bauli, but I prefer to use the word they use. These bodies continued to meet the water needs of the population until the 20th century, and some of these arrangements are still in place after 350 years. Sorry, this is out of... The bodies were an integral part of community life, supplying water to communities, serving as places for bathing and washing, and were associated with sacred rituals and festivals. Additionally, they served as city markers. As you can see, there is a big change in the surrounding uses of the body in the before and after views. Surrounded by gardens and with ample resting spaces for caravans, travelers and pilgrims, the bodies were important centers of communal life. However many of them fell into disuse, and until recently were little more than cesspools. Local initiatives. However, there is hope offered for Bijapur's bodies in some local initiatives that have surfaced in the last few years. As reported in November 2017 by The Hindu, a local daily, one such initiative to revive the bodies has been pioneered by a local community member, a Mr. Aminuddin Huller, described in the report as an activist and a heritage enthusiast. Thanks to his pioneering efforts, around 16 historic bodies in Bijapur are being revived. A water resource minister in the state government, who recognized the efforts towards the revival of the bodies, initiated by Mr. Buller, mobilized various major contractors and industries to offer financial aid under corporate social responsibility and entrusted the job to the City Corporation to be completed in a time-bound manner. As reported in the Daily, work on 6 bodies out of the 16 identified is set for the first phase. The remaining, the Hindu reported, would be taken up when permission from the ASI was received and more funding made available, as some of the bodies are under ASI jurisdiction. Once filled with garbage, the water in the Taj body was drawn out, the silt accumulated over decades removed, and the body replenished with water from sources located at several points along the walls. The entrance to the body is now guarded by government officials, and a fence is erected around it to prevent people from immersing Ganesh idols and throwing garbage in it. In an interview with Frontline magazine, the minister was quoted as saying, "This is a dream fulfilled. The plan is to meet a part of Bijapura's water needs through these bodies. The city requires 65 million liters of water daily, and I expect that at least 5 million liters can be met through these wells. All these wells have potable water, and moreover, it is the heritage of our elders. We should preserve these monuments for the future." Thus, Bijapur is said to have made an exemplary move for combating drought and achieving some degree of self-sufficiency in water utilization by rejuvenating traditional water resources and employing traditional water harvesting techniques. This is the present condition of the body. Another local group of social activists, known as the Deccan Heritage Vision, charged with raising heritage awareness, has been responsible for a major clean-out operation of Bijapur's monuments. Seem to have missed that one. As reported in May 2015 in the local daily, every Sunday morning at the crack of dawn, a group of over 25 people gather at a particular ancient monument in Bijapura to clean the surroundings of the monument. They carry out heritage walks around monuments, and those with knowledge of the particular monument share it with others. The group also discusses ideas for widening its activities, such as for introducing heritage awareness programs in schools in order to involve students in the group's activities and increase awareness of the significant layers contributing to the overall character of the monuments. Finally, ways forward, and this is the last item I'm going to read out. A management plan from the ASI defining conservation policies and objectives is required. Such a plan should act as a regulatory framework for different actions required for long-term management of Bijapur's historic core. Some actions might be physical interventions linking major heritage sites with the surrounding localities, rearranging traffic networks, and pedestrianizing some key public areas. Other actions could result in the passing of regulations concerning use and reuse of heritage sites. Still others could possibly serve to define implementation guidelines and suggest alternative management and administrative procedures, such as establishing a public subsidy initiative or creating a mixed public-private program. Based on the potentials identified above and the needs of stakeholders, it seems important to consider the water networks as the structuring element, restitching it in the urban fabric and strengthening its connection with the social layers of the city, as has been proposed by Mr. Rupa Chikalgi of the Bangalore School of Architecture and Planning. An open space network integrated with the water network, including the moat and bodies, and connecting selected monuments in the historic core that have gardens and surrounding open spaces, is envisaged. the selection of monuments in areas with relatively low level conflict in terms of religious sensitivity and physical encroachment would allow for engagement and positive interaction. A heritage walk linking up the bodies, monuments in the vicinity, the moat, the mausoleum gardens, and some of the palaces within the citadel, which are frequented by the local population, is seen as a way forward. The possibility of engaging local communities actively along this network through the provision of fruit and vegetable and arts and crafts markets, exhibition spaces and art galleries, which are non-existent in Bijapur, should be considered. An open space network that caters to the recreational needs of all local communities without favoring anyone in particular appears a reasonable strategy towards integrating the heritage sites within the historical core. The monuments should be made more accessible to the public by opening up side and back entries where possible and by reinforcing historic pedestrian ways through settlements around these, as at the Ibrahim Rosa. I'm sorry, I missed out that last slide. If conservation has instituted alienation in Bijapur so far, if the stories of Bijapur's ancestors have been forgotten, it is time to reinvent conservation, to allow Bijapur's heritage to become relevant for its people so that they can claim trusteeship over it, think of it as home, and care for the songs and shadows it surrounds them with. To quote Anubhav Pradhan, an urban research fellow with the Indian Institute of Human Settlements, born of vanity and vision, Bijapur symbolizes a fusion of form, space, and time, not only in terms of what it once was, but what it can be. Thank you.